Good morning, everyone. Good morning. We are truly, truly thrilled here at the African Development Center, you to come out and take a time out of your day to welcome with us Joanne Staley of the Minneapolis Foundation. Thank you for coming out. My name is Hussein Samatar, and I am the founding executive director of the African Development Center. This work would not have been possible without the staff of the African Development Center. I want to thank Ismahan Sadiq, who is really early in the morning and ensures that all of our breakfasts go smooth. Thank you, Ismahan. Matthew Holm. Matt Holm is our communications and fund development manager. Thank you, Matt, for the work. Liban, who is recording this program, and this 1 hour program will be seen in many places, and thank you for that. We also have Elias of Mogadishu Times to be here with us today. Again, thank you so much. Now, before I go to the content of the work itself that we are here for today, I would love to take a time and everybody in a quick manner to tell us who you are and who you're with. And I will start with my friend Steve Peacock.
I'm Steve Peacock with Augsburg College.
Linda Fox, Goodwill, Easter Seals, Minnesota.
Trish Olson, University of Minnesota.
Tony Morley, the last thing I retired from was called Colored Magazine. That's about time. Lisa Lazio, Micro Grants.
Janelle Zyden, Minneapolis 81.
Missy Dykstra, Community Involvement Programs.
Good to have you out.
I'm Al Swintek with Centerpoint Energy.
PJ Doyle, Mixed Blood Theater.
Eunice Eckerly, Trinity.
Shelly Jacobson, Twin Cities Rise.
Sheldon Maines, and I guess today I'll say I'm from Seuer Neighborhood Group.
Mary Mellon, West Bank Business Association and
Enterprise. Malcolm, and I'm a Native American advocate.
All right. And Rich.
Hi, Rich Thomas Guard, African Development Center.
Good to have you out. Again, good morning and welcome. We are truly thrilled to be talking this topic today, One Minneapolis. And I just like the title. We should have come up first before Minneapolis Foundation, and that's okay. So we will use it quite a bit. Again, we'll tell you a little bit about the African Development Center. And then I will be out of your way so we can get into the program itself that you are here for today. At the African Development Center, we are a community economic development. We believe ourselves to be social entrepreneurs. We believe you can only help yourself when somebody helps you along the way. But at the end of the day, you have to help yourself. We own this building. We rehabbed it in 2009. And this building used to be the North Cooperative Grocery Store, which was a fantastic grocery store, went out of business. And we have a beautiful African art, African American, African art. Anytime you are in the neighborhood, please stop by 9 to 5. It's open to the public. If you have events, this space is available. And we use for the training that we do, but also the functions that we have. Anytime you can come and you can talk to Ismahan, and she will make sure that you will have the best time possible, as always. Thank you, Ismahan. We are 10 of us. We are here, this building, but also we have two offices in the greater Minnesota. Our new office is in Wilmer, Minnesota. We just bought and rehabbed a building there. We have been busy throughout the summer there. In case people don't know, there is a large and growing African community in Wilmer, especially downtown, is almost the old, especially downtown, is all the Latino and the African community. We also have another office in Rochester, Minnesota, and that is an extremely growing city due to the Mayo Clinic and the healthcare sector there. So it has been also a great city to be there and partner an organization that we do business with there. So that's really essentially in terms of logistics. We are being number one micro lender, small business lender in the city of Minneapolis for some time. We do business lending, training, and housing work around education and financial literacy. Now, in Wilmer, the community is growing so fast, and they're doing amazing businesses. We are in the process of seeing if we can acquire a small mall downtown Wilmer and rehab it for the community. That's essentially the African Development Center. But the reason today that we invited you all and to come and share a data, we are extremely proud that the Minneapolis Foundation took the time to collect on behalf of the community for some time. Now, Joanne Staley will get to the details, but let suffice to say, so you remember, we had an amazing senator, senator from Minnesota, Paul Wellstone, and he used to say all the time, and I remember, we only do better when we all do better. And it will be extremely difficult to sustain a community that the gap is so wide, have and have nots. So it's all our responsibility in any level of leadership and in any level of being a community member to find to bridge the gap. But we cannot bridge any gap unless we know what the gap looks like and who is being left behind. And that's where Joanne today comes in and her organization to tell us what they found out and then us to do what we can do to bridge the gap for everybody. Now, finally, I am a school board member at the Minneapolis Public Schools. I am not extremely fond how we count when we say that there is an achievement gap between the white and the people of color. I really say that we want our white children to do even more and even better. And we just also want equally people of color, children of color, to do more. When we all do more or get where we're going, then we feel we have a stake. So again, welcome. We are thrilled to welcome Joanne Staley, who is the director of Grantmaking and Special Projects at the Minneapolis Foundation. Joanne has a long career and understanding in grantmaking and relationship building. She was with the Indian Land Tenure Foundation before, also the St. Paul Foundation, Indian Health Board of Minneapolis, Minnesota Indian Affairs Council, and F.R. Bigelow Foundation. In all of these positions, she has worked on projects dealing with issues of diversity, healthcare, homelessness, affordable housing, job readiness, and understanding economic development at the neighborhood level. We are truly, truly, truly thrilled this new report from Minneapolis Foundation to be broken here today by Joanne Staley. Please welcome Joanne.
Good morning, everyone. This is a beautiful facility. Well, on behalf of Sandy Vargas, who is our president and CEO, I am delighted to be here and to talk a little bit about this report that you now have in your hands. This is called One Minneapolis. It's a community indicators report. Hussein's comments about this vision, it's a vision of One Minneapolis. And the title is kind of a purpose to say that is the vision that's not where we are today, unfortunately. And so what we hope to do by having this research completed is to put this in the hands of every citizen in the city of Minneapolis, everyone who resides in the city. Each of us has a role to play when we want to talk about how can we have models, what can we do to improve the various gaps that we have highlighted in this particular report. I would like to call attention to our partner who was Wilder Research. We have worked with them for over a year and a half in helping us to identify what we felt were community indicators that we needed to pay attention to. And as part of our own strategic plan, these do represent our strategies of the Minneapolis Foundation, how we are investing our resources to make our community better. We have three primary focus areas that we focus on as a community foundation. We believe in looking at our education. We call it transforming education. Our other focus area is promoting economic vitality. And our third area of focus is building social capital. So throughout this report, and as we identified indicators, and there are 24 indicators across those three focus areas, those align again with our strategies as the Minneapolis Foundation. But we feel that it is good for the whole community to look at those areas of focus to see where we can create change in a positive movement in the areas that we feel are very critical for us to have a very vital and vibrant and thriving community. So if I can do this clicker correctly. There. As I said, we worked with Wilder Research in helping to identify these various community indicators. And these community indicators are aligned with other efforts. But what makes this report different is that this really is looking not only at race, we try to break things down by ethnicity and other subgroups. And we use specifically existing data points that are out there so that we could have a continual measure of this particular report. And we are going to update this report on an annual basis. So we consider this baseline data at this point. And we used information that Wilder Research already collects through its Compass reports, Minneapolis School District, we have the Blueprint for Action, and results of Minneapolis. And in here, we also focus on nativity where we can to break down the data even further. Because we found in some of the other reports, we might get an average, and it looks like we're doing very well. But when we break down those averages, that's where we're getting to see where the discrepancies are and where the gaps are in these particular indicators. We also tried to look at things by language. It's very important to kind of break it down even further when possible to do that. Wrong way. I might need some technical assistance with this, Mark. Thank you. As Mark is coming up here, I'd also like just to give you kind of an idea of how this report is laid out. This is the complete report, and then this represents what we call a dashboard of kind of the whole report. So it's very easy for people to pull out, have handy for you to use, keep it at your desk, put it on your wall. It kind of breaks down what we thought were some of the highlights of this particular report to give you an indication where we are across those three focus areas. We also used a method of indicating by the dots and the color dots of where we are on each of these indicators. And if you will note, we have a lot of red and orange, but we have no green dots. So by not having any green dots, that means that gap, that equity discrepancy is huge. And we have a lot of work to do before us. In the actual report, you have your table of contents, and it gives you, in the table of contents, it is broken down by each of the 24 community indicators. And each of those indicators then within the report also each has a two-page kind of spread on each of those indicators, what makes it easy for you to pull out, to look at those areas of indicators to say what's happening, where the areas are, who's doing well, who's not doing well, and some of the recommendations that we have as it pertains to those groups, subgroups that are doing fairly well, those subgroups that are not doing very well at all. So now it looks like I'm back up. Okay, thank you. When we look at the population at a glance and some of the things that we found out by looking at the population of Minneapolis, you can see a breakdown, of course, by race. But if we're looking at kind of population between white and non-white population, we have 40% of the city of Minneapolis is represented by very diverse communities, ethnicities, and races. It's 40%. For our researchers, and even among ourselves when we were talking, again, the 40%, really helped, I think, to really pinpoint what is happening in our community and how the community has changed in the last 10 years, and also what the community may look like in the next 20 years. Overall population, we really didn't lose population, but there was definitely a mix in who the population is now represented by. It's an 11% of the population is Hispanic, and it may be represented by other racial groups above. So clearly you can see, again, kind of what the distribution of the population now looks like in 2010. As I said, when we looked at kind of trying to give you an easy way to navigate through this various reports, on the scale from green to red, those dots are kind of those measures to show kind of basically where the gaps are. And with the gaps, we also break it down by not only the gaps, but you can see what the overall averages are, but then you can also see the range of what the gaps are in each of those particular indicators. And we talk about equity. Equity is very much embedded into the work that we do at the Minneapolis Foundation. And I think Hussein gave a pretty good indication of what equity means when we're talking about that in our community. We want all people to do well, and we want to remove any of those big discrepancies between groups so that we are all achieving equity. And we believe equity is so vital to our city, it's vital to the region, it's vital to the state. Minneapolis is an engine, and we want to do the best that we possibly can for all people that reside here. This is just kind of showing the way to navigate with the colored dots. And here, under our focused area education, we found that the greatest gaps, racial gaps, is in the area of education. We also use education because this education probably has the most data that is being collected that we can use and review on an annual basis. And so within education, these are the indicators that we're looking at. Are kindergartners ready for school? What's happening with third grade reading? Are students graduating on time? And as you can see, the dots are quite red when we're talking about kids being ready for kindergarten. The range there is from 36% up to 94%. And most of the higher percentages, that does represent the white population throughout this report. So when we look at kindergartners being ready for school, most white kindergartens, 94% of them, are ready to enter school. 36, that represents the Latino or Hispanic population not being ready for school. So that's over a 50%, 58-point gap in disparities. That's very, very significant. And we need to change that. Very clear that we need to change that. When we move down to children and youth, Minneapolis children living in poverty, from 14 to 70%, right now, one out of three children are living in poverty in the city of Minneapolis. Less than 3 years ago, it was one out of four. So it is going up. I said that wrong. One out of three, it's now one out of four. No, one out of three. Excuse me, that's correct. So our poverty rates are going up. And we know that a lot of this is due to the economy, but this hasn't really changed that much when we're talking about the diversity and the issues of race and ethnicity among our communities as well. Again, showing where our high dots are, where we need to have significant improvement. And again, our most critical point, the largest discrepancy, is with having our young children prepared and ready for school. 70% looks pretty good, but when we break it down, when you actually see where the percentages are, for non-white children, this is a very, very warning sign for us of what we need to do to really address getting our kids ready for school. That's showing the gap. What we also found is that kindergartners who speak Spanish in their home are the least likely to be ready for kindergarten. I mean, we looked at language, whether language is the primary language, if you're native born, foreign born, what is the language in the home? And we found, again, by breaking it down to subgroups, that we know that our Spanish speaking kids are having more difficulty. However, on the opposite end, which was a surprise to us, was what was happening with Somali youth. that the Somali youth were very close to same as white youth in being prepared and entering kindergarten. And we don't know why. So we have to find out. We need to go out and have some conversations within the community to determine that and find out why they are better prepared. What makes them different? Even though that English may not be the primary language, what makes them different than any other home where English is not the primary language? The other critical point here is when we're looking at what happens with suspension of students. When you're suspended for school, and in most cases, kids that are suspended for school are kind of suspended for school for like 10 days, kind of that range is 10 days. And we also find that it's more African American or black students that are being suspended from school and American Indian students that are being suspended for school. And this is across, even in kindergarten, kids are being suspended from school. And you ask yourself, well, what could that be for? I mean, it's not for carrying weapons or bringing something to school. Most of it has to do with behavior. So what is happening in our schools? Why our students are being suspended? And if you're not in school, you're not going to learn. And so it's very critical for us to address this issue. What is happening in our schools? Looking at reading, another critical indicator is that students are able to read by the third grade. There's kind of this mantra about you're getting ready to read when you're going to third grade, but after you're in third grade, then you start learning. That's when the actual learning takes place. So if you've missed this critical gap of being able to read and read proficiently, you are going to be handicapped if you are not able to meet that mark by third grade. And some of the challenges are that students in being tested, the testing really doesn't happen, and testing is happening all along, but it's not until third grade testing where you then actually can be eligible to get additional support if you're not reading proficiently. So even though a child could be struggling in first grade and second grade, the services are not there until after the third grade tests are administered. So we're losing that opportunity for an intervention. For most students of color, English proficiency drives reading, except for black students. So we have to think about what can we do better. And the chart kind of shows, again, whether it's English learners versus being proficient, kind of what the differences in the percentages are. And for white students, 88% are proficient. Even looking at American Indian students, where it's not necessarily a language issue, only 43% are proficient in reading. So we know these, again, are very kind of those critical points where we think we can move the dial, we have the opportunity to create change in what's happening with the education of our students. As we look at employment, as I said, that the population in Minneapolis, 40% is represented by communities of color, different races and ethnicities. When we look at that and seeing what does the employment look like in the city of Minneapolis, only 17% of that population is actually holding jobs. So the majority of jobs, whether they're residents of Minneapolis representing whites or residents outside Minneapolis, whites are holding the majority of the jobs. So you can see what the differences are. If it's 40%, we'd expect it to be close to 40% representing communities of color and where the jobs are being held. 3/4 are employed full-time, and Hispanic adults are only second to whites in the percentage of being employed. Again, the lower of the American Indian population is at 51%, black African American at 58% of being employed. So when you think about our city and this representation for the area, how can we be a vital economic engine or providing an economy when we have such a large discrepancy? That's very difficult to do. 68% of foreign black adults are working compared to 53%. This is where we were able to go deeper into the data and desegregate it to find out a little bit more. So if you're foreign born, you come here, or you're recently arrival, or you've been somewhat established, you're going to have a higher employment rate than someone who's lived here for their whole life or their whole family has been here for generations. Why is there that difference? Children in poverty, I had mentioned this before, that the rate of children in poverty is going up. This is 22,400 kids in the city. Children of Asian immigrants are most likely to live in poverty. Now, in other points for the Asian community, in education, in some other areas, they are doing okay, except when we look at this as an indicator in employment, it's not translating. So even if you have education, you're reading better, you're being more successful in school, and looking at the data, something is happening when you get to that point of being employed. And then Hispanic children are the least likely among children of color to be in poverty. And we've had some discussions, is that because the families are both working, a mother and father, or families coming together to kind of create an economic kind of base for the various families? Again, something that we would like to look further at, but clearly for the Hispanic children, they are the least likely at this point to be living in poverty. And of course, it's showing here again that for Black or African American kids, they're vastly outnumbered as far as children living in poverty. As I mentioned, these are the three focus areas that we are looking at: education, economic vitality, and building social capital. As I pointed into your book, we have two-page spread on each of those indicators that tries to pull out more data for you to review to go deeper to find out what's happening in each of those focus areas. What's next? A very critical, kind of critical question here. Very important. Why are we doing this? As I said, we each have a role to play. As the Minneapolis Foundation, we view our role as one, certainly a grant maker. Some people know us as grant makers because we provide unrestricted dollars to support those areas that I've already highlighted. But we also have a role as being a convener. And this is an opportunity to be part of that. When others ask us to be part of a process, they're serving as a convener, then we come in as a partner to do that. And the other is in that partnership of how do we get kind of the community to look at this information as a whole. We all know that we cannot do this singularly. We are greater when we're all operating together. So our goal with this particular report is to make sure that we provide as much information getting in the hands, as I said before, every person that resides here in the city, every policymaker, talking to the city council, talking to Hennepin County, talking to our legislators, talking to the various community groups, so that this can be usable data for you in your work and in your planning and what you're doing to improve your neighborhood in some places, or to help you with your business, or to help you even with your own your family, your relatives, and your friends. We wanted this to be a very usable document for you to have at hand, to take with you, to look at. And then at the end, I'm going to be asking for some feedback, because we know we couldn't consider everything in this process, by no means, and that we will be looking at maybe adjusting some of the indicators based on what we hear from you and other groups that we're going to be meeting with throughout this next year before we do the next report, which will be available in April. Then I have questions that I'd like to throw out for you to have the opportunity to discuss briefly. We've done this with our grantees, and this is the presentation we did with our grantees on Monday. We want you to kind of get into either small groups or kind of talk with each other across your various tables and think about these questions. For you personally, what seems to be the most relevant of some of these indicators as it pertains to your work? What data surprised you the most, if something really kind of startled you? And I know you haven't read the whole report, but kind of highlighted some of those things that we have found. And how is your organization or your business working towards addressing some of these issues? And then there was a fourth one, and it somehow disappeared on me as I was adjusting this PowerPoint. But then we want to talk about what ideas you have or what models that you are aware of that are working in addressing some of these gaps. And then we'll have an opportunity for some questions and answers. We certainly have had a lot of feedback from our other groups about some other possible indicators, or why we did or why we didn't. And I'll be very happy to get into that discussion as well. But for now, I'd like to take about 10 minutes.
This would be fine. Just because of the limitation of the cameras and the TV and everything else, if all possible, to make it an open discussion, people, if we
all could, right.
So people can say in out and
then. All right. So like, then you'll just, you know, raise your hand, whatever you'd like to do. So for the first one, what indicator is most relevant to your work? And again, we have the indicators broken down into kind of education. We have it broken down into economic vitality, and that's jobs and housing. And then the third one is on social capital. And that's, we talk a lot about civic engagement and representation, or how children feel, and about trusted adults or having people in their community that they can relate to. So I know we have a very variety of individuals that are here that do represent the gamut of what our business looks like here in the community, and some of our nonprofits, and also in education. So which one is most relevant to the work that you do?
And just do a favor, use the microphone so we you and the rest of the community will know what you just said.
The one that I'm most interested in is the representative leadership. And it was interesting that you only looked at elections. Hussein didn't, the first thing he did was not run for the school board. The first thing he did was not get on the library board. He was active in his community first. So it seems to me that the indicator here should start at a much lower level of what's the participation in community activities.
So, and we totally agree with that. But as I said, what we looked at, again, what is already out there is something that's already being captured to start to use as a data point without having to go out and create and do and spend more dollars to do that. So we definitely understand that. We know that path to leadership can go in various ways. And actually at the Minneapolis Foundation, we are thinking about what leadership looks like, how do we encourage leadership, and that really is under our building social capital as a grant maker that we're trying to encourage through our grants and at the ground level. But I totally agree with you that, you know, that's not necessarily the best, but that's the one that we could identify at this point to point to some type of civic engagement, along with voting, I mean, to try to provide a measure of that. And it's not only elected positions, but again, that's the point that we can find. There are people that are in leadership positions that are non-elected that are very, very important, that drive policy and impact our lives on a regular basis. So, and if you have suggestions that might be a better data point that you're aware of, we definitely are interested in knowing about that. Okay, yes? Mr. Banks? Yep.
Okay. Well, I took some notes here. I've got it here. Okay.
Yes.
I took some notes here on some of the things that you were talking about, and one thing is the problem that you have with education. And since we only use the didactic model, which isn't serviceable for a lot of populations, especially non-white, you're going to have some failure. And in some cases, you're going to have a lot of failure because they're, you know, if the product doesn't fit the consumer, then the consumer isn't benefiting from it. So making a shift to other educational models other than the didactic would be helpful. And then when you talk about some populations work better with the educational system, they're able to adapt better because some of these people, especially the immigrants, are coming from areas where there was no education. So tying into something that is structured, even though it's foreign to them, they gravitate to and they adapt to. Mm-hmm. And then when you talk about the problems with youth, young youth interacting with one another, mm-hmm. if the youth has no experience in interacting with other populations, there's going to be conflict because the unknown is always difficult. And then when you were talking about reading and the capabilities, like with my population, we have an oral tradition. Reading is not part of our makeup. Although, I mean, we read, but most of the interaction is oral. And then when you talk about work, it differs by populations because some people work for others, whereas some populations, it's a community thing where they work together. And especially like with the Hispanic. Mm-hmm. They work together as a population and they all, I wouldn't generalize it, but they do the same type of work, and they're working, but they're not working for the dominant culture.
To respond to, again, looking at the Minneapolis Public Schools as kind of that base system, that is kind of the public school kind of institution with the data points that we're looking at, and I totally agree that there have to be some other options. We do not have information on, like, charter schools that are ready yet, but that's something that we are considering, and we know there have been a variety of different schools that have been set up, particularly for, you know, special population or special interests, that are having wonderful results, that are outperforming what we're seeing for data in Minneapolis public schools.
But again, it's like with the charter schools, I'm a participant with PIE, which stands for Phillips Indian Education.
You're one of our grantees.
And I'm probably the only non-academician in the group. So I'm more able to say what they're fearful of saying because they're part of the system. And we're trying to make the changes so that the educational models that we're accustomed to are utilized. But the problem is, it's kind of like what the Navy does. I can get compression socks in any color that they want, as long as they're black. So when it comes to when it comes to education, the Board of Education lets us do whatever we want as long as you stick to the didactic model.
Right.
So there's not a whole lot of freedom there. Mm-hmm. And it was like you were talking about the poor indicators for kids going into school. Well, we have a problem here in the city. I mean, most of us are born dual citizens,
mm-hmm.
which is a whole new different thing for everybody else. But the parents, and a lot of them before them, were never enculturated into their culture. So then we wind up with a whole lot of apples. They're red on the outside, but they're white to the core. And this is problematic because if you don't uphold the values of your culture, interactions, whether it's with your own people or somebody else, is going to be strained.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, that's another factor that mm-hmm. isn't even discussed when it comes to, you know, the cultural ramifications.
I did also want to respond to when you talked about employment. That I didn't highlight in here is that a number of self-employed or startup businesses, we see that more in communities of color than, as you said, working for someone. And you, I think you kind of referenced to that maybe in the Latino population where they come together, work together on particular trades perhaps. But that was encouraging to see, I think, particularly with Hussein and the work that you're doing, where we're seeing more enterprise happening within various groups to develop their own businesses or how they're going to choose to work and be employed or self-employed rather than in the larger sector.
Yeah, that worked for me too because I always work for somebody else, and I realized I can't do that any longer. So I own two businesses,
mm-hmm.
one and then another, not in succession, but I mean in succession, but not together. So that was the only way that I could ever get ahead,
mm-hmm.
was to be my own boss. Mm-hmm. And I was making six figures.
Very good. Other questions? Yes.
Hi. I'm with Mixed Blood Theater, and the point that I really that resonates with me is the residents who feel unaccepted because of their race, ethnicity, or culture, and that certainly fits with Mixed Blood's mission of really building social capital by bringing multiple cultures together and being better for the experience of learning and using theater as the vehicle to
mm-hmm.
do that.
Mm-hmm.
So that information really helps us in our planning and in our measurement, so we now have some baseline indicators to work with, and as we begin to track, it really is helpful for us.
Well, and that is one of the indicators, again, based on the survey and using the data point, where that actually improved. I mean, it dropped, I think, from 17% to 9%. But it's still there, and that's still very significant. And it could go up again. We'll see. I think that's very important. Any other on that first question about the work that you do? Al?
Yes, hi. I'm with CenterPoint Energy, and one of the things that's of interest to us is affordable housing, and organizations like Habitat and Aon and several others that do affordable housing work. What I'm wondering about in the report, if you could talk about the importance, maybe not even of affordable housing, but the importance of a stable place to call home, and how that has an impact, if you know of any impacts that that has, mm-hmm. on all of these other mm-hmm. dashboard indicators.
Well, a very good point, and to say that these are all interrelated and interconnected in some way, and bringing out housing and affordable housing and providing stability to the family is very critical, as that relates to the education of a child. It's very hard for a child to get a very good education if they're constantly on the move and they're losing more school days because they don't have a stable family. Or not having a stable family with a home is also probably related to what their employment situation is like or what their economic support is. And for Minneapolis, I must say that we considered ourselves to be the forerunners of creating affordable housing, that we were kind of a model to do that. But as you can see, even in this report, we have lost significant ground on the availability of affordable housing. And because of the economic situation of our families, we have a higher demand for affordable housing. So we have really lost ground. Even though we focused on production, creating more affordable housing units, I think the discrepancy is almost twofold for those individuals that should have affordable housing available to meet what their economic status is. It simply is not there. Well, let's go to two again, and this might be related to, but what surprised you the most about any of these data points? Tony.
I want to point on page 13 to an item that surprised me and obviously surprised you too, which was the question, are kindergartners ready for school, broken out by home language? And what you reported was that Somali kids are ready for school at almost the same rate as English kids and
yes.
far above others. And that provokes the question to me, a question about the question. And this relates to what the man was saying about didactic model. There's a certain bias in the question, are kids ready for school, which throws the responsibility for that back on the kids and their families. And the question needs to be matched, and I wish this would happen more often, are the schools ready for the kids? Because clearly, in some important sense, the schools that you're talking about are not ready for, or much less ready for Spanish, Hmong, and American Indian, and African American kids, except for Somali. The schools are not ready for those kids. And the question then becomes, and that surprises me about the Somali statistic, because that provokes the question, in what sense are our Minneapolis schools more ready for Somali kids at kindergarten than they are for American Indian kids, for example? And I don't know who's ever looked into that question or whether anybody's looked into it, but it seems to me the place to look is at the schools and not at the kids.
If I may, to really set the record straight as much as I can. This is definitely a new data, as Joanne said, new in terms of revealing to the community and seeing what's happening out there. And as I said at the beginning, we are extremely grateful to the Minneapolis Foundation to actually dig and find out data sets points that are already there and congregate so we could fill the gap. But let me set the record straight. If you are in Minnesota and 9/11 happened, and you happen to be black, and you happen to be immigrant, and you happen to be also Muslim, it's extremely tenuous position to be in, whether we like it or not like it. Now, the Somali American community have been accused left, right, center all the time, especially in the media. When things go wrong with the community. There's no question about it. They are new immigrants and they have a lot of issues they are struggling with, such as youth of the community and sometimes function that happens within the first generation and the second generation immigrants of the community. And that, by the way, has been for every immigrant group. Just look the Hmong community. How that has been the case. Now, let me go over the data set points about it. I'm a Minneapolis Public School board member, and I can really tell you, you're absolutely right what you said about, are the schools, is the district ready for all the children? But this time, I will give it to you that That's a great question, and we need to explore. But let me focus more about the Somali community. Had this data showed that the children of the Somali American community who speak Somali, they are Americans as anybody else, but speak Somali at home, had it shown that they only ready one third of the time, most of the people would have said, what's wrong with them? Why are they not making their children ready? But now, all of a sudden, we have a 76% of the Somali children making the question is really that, oh my goodness, how are they doing it? And now, the reason they're doing it really, he get it right, is really that being immigrant, by the way, that goes for the Swedish, the Danish, the Norwegian, for everybody. They know very clearly, we are not defining the standard of success. The larger community is defining the standard of success. What are we doing really that, as any other immigrant, how can I educate my children the best possible way so they have a shot in life in the United States? So those all young women, predominantly I will give the credit to the Somali woman, I will take myself out of there, do whatever it takes any given day and any given night to make sure that that child is ready for a school. And I see this data will be consistent, hopefully, as the annual data is being updated. The second number, the Somali American community have been accused again many times. They're not participating, or most of the immigrants, they're not participating in the labor market. As you really saw, 68% of foreign-born are trying to hold the jobs because they have no way out but to get into the labor market. Finally, I appreciated my brother what he said about didactic way of teaching, and he's absolutely right. But I will tell you as an immigrant, whether it's didactic or not didactic, at the end of the day, for them is how can I succeed within the given structure of the system while I want to change the system. But I don't have the power at this level to be the policymaker because none of us outside of me was elected to anything. So therefore, it takes time to have a policy position. Therefore, what can I do to impact the community? Finally, I'm going to go back what you all know. When the Swedes came to the United States and they used to live in Sweet Hollow, everybody said they're not going to amount to anything. And now, not only they amounted to something, they have one of the largest companies in this state. So my point being really that we're either going to look at the totality of the data and make it better, or the communities will always find ways to make sure that their children are better off. That doesn't mean all the Somali American community are doing well, but we are extremely delighted to see that the mothers are pushing the children to be ready for school. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Tony. And thank you, Hussein. But as I said, we do want to look at that more closely. I think as Karen Kelly Arulo said, who is our vice president, she says, what are those Somali mamas doing? Basically, what are they doing? And we need to learn what they're doing in order to make that hopefully work for other kids as
it's
well.
Wonderful, but what it says is to me is that the schools know how to deal with and respond to and serve the parents who are saying, my kids are going to get educated no matter what, okay? But doesn't tell you what are the schools not doing that makes them fail so with American Indian kids.
It's a good, okay? That's good, it's true. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Do you have
a microphone for please? Thank you.
Well, I'm going to say something about this kindergarten thing. I'm not by no means an expert on this, but I will talk as a parent. I have a second grade and a kindergarten and two preschools. And relates to what somebody said around here that whether the schools are responding to parents who are saying, I want my kids to succeed. When I by the way, I go to schools and I take trips and all that, and when I talk to teachers and all that and other parents, what I hear from immigrants is that whenever they engage with a teacher, they always see a positive change in the way they deal with their kid, and you know, they sit down and set the goals with them, they always see a positive change from the school. So if you combine the efforts the parent is making and the response the school is giving whenever you engage with them, I think there will be no doubt that you will see some positive results. But again, this is a very new data, so we still need to find out why this is the case with the Somali kids. But I have another question, which is, we're just stopping here at kindergarten and breaking down this into home language. But when you go and see these gaps and to the other levels, for example, the third grade and that, we don't see this disaggregated data.
Not yet.
Because sometimes I go into this data and see the trends might be a general trend. So you just find that first time these black kids, for example, will pick up. Mm-hmm. But somewhere along the way, I don't know, something breaks down. Right. So I don't know. So as a parent, that makes me very nervous. My daughter, for example, would, as a second grader, will read like a third grade. But when you see this kind of data, you start, you know. So that's what I'm saying. So it might be a good idea maybe to start to break down this along the way, at least at every important stage, like, for example, third grade when we have this state tests, and maybe a fifth grade. And
fifth grade for math, we know we have that as a point. Okay. We're going to start looking at. And then by eighth grade, again, it's one of those critical points. But
I do want to follow up when you talked about the parent engagement. And it's on page 28 of the reports when it's talking about parents being surveyed and how important that is. I mean, we see that overall, most parents are satisfied, or they're kind of, they feel that the importance of what the schools are very important for them and their lives. And for all parents, it's 79%. And the district itself wants to have, I think, a goal of 89% of parents responding to the survey that they're very satisfied with what's happening with their school. And even when you're looking across the board with the American Indian population or even the black population, that's still very high, but the student's performance is not. So there is this kind of, maybe, Tony, what you're saying, there's a disconnect of what's happening. And we've had explanations coming from our various groups, too, that this can be cultural. There's a lot of respect that may be given to teachers, and parents are just turning their kids with this great faith that the school is going to educate them, and they're not going to challenge the system. And so, of course, they're responding, they're satisfied, and yet they're not connecting what's happening with the performance of their children in the school. So, again, I think that is that critical point. So even if parents are engaged, we need to kind of think about how do we even take them further so that that engagement, I think much like the gentleman had referred here, that the kids will also start to perform better. We also see the students responding that they feel that they have a very good relationship with their teachers. So what is happening? Again, where we're seeing poor performance, but the students feel connected, feel like they're being appreciated, feeling that they have a connection with their individual teachers as well. So there, as I said, there are things that just aren't kind of lining up with what we're seeing for the actual results when we're talking about student achievement. Again, it's more for us to consider. But again, we know those are critical points that need to be addressed. It does make a difference in what happens in the education of that child. We only have about, I'd say, 3 minutes left before we have to wrap up by 9. Joe.
Since in the interest of time, I'd like to move to that third one about what our organization's doing to influence the indicators. I've been hearing wonderful data like this for the last 40 years. I've been working with the poor, and they're always startling images about the gaps. And when I get people to work with my boards at either Project for Pride and Living or microgrants, they want to try and fix little things there. But I think the bigger thing is, what are we doing? I tell my board now at microgrants, don't tell us to tinker with how we're helping the poor people, but get more rich people and more businesses involved in really paying attention to data like this. They're the ones with the power. I'm really glad CenterPoint Energy is here, and there should be more like that. As Minneapolis Foundation's in a great position, too, to do that, to influence wealthy families, too, and the 1% club's been kind of floundering. But those are the people that have to be convinced to invest some money in the long term to really make some change here. Do you have any comments on that kind of strategy for the Minneapolis Foundation or us?
We've we've talked about kind of the opportunities, real partnerships with the business communities, and of course there are other funders that have invested a lot of their dollars towards education
and improving situations within the school. You know, Target, Cargill are doing that, but our business community is a benefactor of what happens with our children who are being educated. And we've heard from the business community that our kids are not coming out of our institutions prepared to work in their industries. So they have this vested interest. So we need to figure out how do we bring that into the classroom. And talking about kind of models that are out there along with the resources that come are kind of those experiences where we can give our youth the opportunity to connect with businesses and think about careers, and how they can have that type of experience working with a Center Point or with General Mills, working in technology that we know the kids want to have that, but we don't have enough slots available to provide those opportunities. So, I mean, that is, a conversation and some of the recommendations kind of coming from some of these conversations right now for us to think about how do we link that much better. We know also with our workforce, we are aging workforce, and we do not have enough kids in the pipeline to replace the jobs of people that are retiring. If you've read the Star Tribune, we do not have enough people right now to fill the jobs that companies are trying to hire for. So, I mean, it is in all our best interest to have the best educated, the best trained, whether it's post-secondary, two-year colleges, whatever it may be, so that we can fill these positions with our populations. And it's from a very diverse population, because the white population is not replacing itself. We either got to bring people in, or the birth rate's going to have to jump up, but that's not going to happen for another 20, 30 years. So right now, we are in very dire trouble. And education, again, is like that linchpin for us to try to see, can we change, can we maneuver that fast enough so that we can meet the immediate needs, but even more, what those future needs are going to look like. And the business community has got to be there with us at the table.
So we have to wrap it up.
All right.
Please help me appreciate and thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. We appreciate it. Thank you, Joanne. You can take it later. Now, this concludes this month's breakfast. Next month, we will have the new dean of the Humphrey Institute, Eric Schwartz, to come and to talk among how and where he will take the Humphrey Public Policy School. Plus, he traveled to Somalia. And hopefully he will tell us what's happening around the famine that has devastated the country. So hopefully you will get an email blast. If you're not, please put down your email. Now, two things before I let you go. As Minnesotan, as an American of a Somali descent, we were extremely, extremely, extremely excited. Finally, as I said it, a good data for the community. The community has really felt for some time, especially some headlines, to label them as if they are aliens from another universe. And it was extremely, extremely sometimes difficult to deal with. We are so grateful that Minneapolis Foundation to go out and dig a data we would not have otherwise read it. We're extremely pleased with this. Obviously, it's a beginning, as my brother Omar said, and we would love to know more. Also, as a school board member, but also as a member of the community, this is not for one community. We only do better, again, as I said it, when we all do better. And I really feel that strongly about if we want to close the achievement gap, we have to make sure that our white children are also 100%, and then put all people of color to achieve as well. Thank you for coming. Thank you, Joanne. We really appreciate it. Thank you so much.